Welcome, friends, to this three-day event we have in New Delhi. I am very happy to see all of you. I am happy to see you because you are all seekers of the same destination that I am a seeker of. We are co-travelers on the same path. Our true home is not in this universe. The physical universe has been created just for a temporary experience. We have come here for a very temporary visit. We don't belong here. And that is why, after we go through the experience of this physical world in our physical bodies, we get tired and we say, this is enough. This world is made of pairs of opposites. There is pain and pleasure. There is night and day. Everything we experience in this world is based upon pairs of opposites. Our true home, to which we belong, to which our soul belongs, does not have this duality, does not have these pairs of opposites. It's always a state of bliss, and it's very different from what it is here. Why did we come here? If we were already in a state of bliss in our true home, what was the need to come here in a world of pairs of opposites? We came here to see something different from our own home, something opposite to our own home. Because there was no opposite in our own home, we came into a world of opposites and made it an opposite of our own home. What happens because of this experience? When we go back to our true home, we realize how great that bliss is. Those who have never left the home do not know what that bliss is. They have never seen anything other than that. Our consciousness becomes aware of things, becomes aware of any experience when it sees its opposite. That is why, since there was no opposite in our true home, we created an experience of opposites and made our true home also an opposite of a world of pairs of opposites. It's a grand scheme, big scheme, to be able to appreciate our true home more and better. So that is why we came here. We did not come here to stay here. We came here for one life, only one human life. We never came to be permanent residents here. We wanted to just test out what it is like to be in a different world, a world which has pairs of opposites, unlike our own true home, and then go back and appreciate our own home better. How did we get stuck here? We got stuck here because we were enabled to have this experience through some devices, through some apparatus. What were the apparatus we used to have an experience of a physical world? We were souls, atma, pure units of consciousness, nothing else. What is consciousness? The ability to become aware of anything. Unlimited power. Consciousness can be conscious of anything, it becomes creation. That great power was there in consciousness to become conscious of anything, become aware of anything, get an experience of awareness. To that, we added an experience which was not there in pure consciousness, or it was hidden, latent in that consciousness, and that was the experience of time and space. We did not need time and space to have bliss. We did not need time and space to have knowledge, true knowledge. We did not need time and space to have the most fundamental part of our own consciousness, the ability to love and be loved. These things existed in our true home. But we wanted to see something different, and therefore we used a small device and attached it to ourselves, attached to our souls. And that device was so powerful to expand the experience into time and space. This device is called the human mind. The human mind, which thinks, rationalizes, makes judgment, evaluates, finds what is good or bad, that mind became our first device. So by that, we were able to put our experience into time and space. That was a great beginning, to put everything into time and space. Once we created that, time was a long line of events. From it created past, present and future, and so we were able to place events on them. Events were all placed at once. All the events that were to come were placed events, placed on that timeline and in space. So there could be something far, something near, something now, something then. These events were created by the mind, and the mind was used by us to experience them, which was a great thing. It's a wonderful experience to come and have that. Then to make it even more interesting, we put on a second attachment, a second cover upon ourselves to see it through some glasses of sense perceptions. That means what we could know instantly with the mind now became seeing, touching, tasting, smelling, hearing, separate. This separation of perception took place through a body of ours, a covering upon our soul, covering upon the mind and soul complex, which we call now a sensory body or an astral body or a sukshma sharir, a fine body. This was just a cover so that we could, now the individuated soul with its mind, could also experience things in different ways. We could hear things, we could see things, we could touch things, we could smell things. This was a great thing, an addition for good experience. We finalized that by putting on a physical body upon ourselves, which of course the physical body itself was a cover upon all these two, the mind, the senses, our own original soul or atma or consciousness, unit of consciousness, all got covered and we became human beings. How did we become so different? If it was just a mechanical thing to put on some costumes and become human being, how did we become different? We became different by choice. We made a choice that when we are having those events, what events are we going to see, at what time, in what place? Those events were all drawn up, planned, almost like a digital program. They were all drawn up, and just for the sake of comparison, I would say, they were made into small DVDs, which we could play. So we looked at all the possible DVDs that could be made, millions, trillions, all possible permutation, combination of events that can be made. But the events on timeline had to be connected with each other. They were not simply flashes of one event and another event. They were connected with each other with a simple principle called cause and effect. Cause and effect links those events upon the timeline, and we thereby created one of the most important recipes for staying here called the law of karma. Law of karma is a simple law. It says that if there is a cause, it will lead to an event, effect. Cause and effect will follow. You then divide, you can divide the experiences then into good and bad. You could add morality to the choice making for those events. We picked up our own DVD. Each DVD was separate. It gave us a separate face, a separate place of birth, a separate life, a separate destiny, a separate set of events for our life. Where did we pick this up from? We picked it up from the mind. The mind was a very big thing. It was not many minds, it was one mind. One mind, one universal mind held all these DVDs, and they were stacked up in the newly created space and time, a newly created huge sky, golden colored sky, very beautifully made so we could enjoy it. In that beautiful sky, we stacked up all these DVDs, and we went and enjoyed that sky, and we picked up one DVD. We looked at the DVD. How does it work? The DVD contained one life, but the life that it contained was based upon the principle of cause and effect. Therefore, you could not have any event in that one life which did not have a cause. did not have a prior life, prior method by which that one life could be created. So actually when we picked up that DVD, there were also past lives attached to it in order to make one life. He never lived those lives. They were just notional. They were attached to the DVD. We came for one life and carried with it past life, memories of past life, which we had never lived. They became our past lives. And therefore, we became subject to the law of karma, law of cause and effect. And a life we had never led became the basis of the life we were now leading. Since the life we are now leading had itself cause and effect, we participated not only in the creation of the DVD, but in the functioning of the system of cause and effect. The system of karma was being worked by us even after putting on the various costumes of sense perceptions and of physical perceptions and a physical body. How was that done? We began to function in this life by hiding all the events that had still to come on the timeline. So we were made blind to our own future. It was already there. The whole life was there before we came. But we became blind to what was going to happen and began to move time travel on the timeline, going from one event to another, guessing what will happen next, trying to find out what will happen next. We found that the DVD contained events, birth from one end, death of the physical body at the other end, in between meeting somebody, making friends, marriages, children, families, jobs, work, store, shopping, whatever was to be done, got all fitted in. But between these events, we were given a period where we could think through the mind. We could use our mind to make choice. The design of the mind was so craftily done that when we began to think what to do, when we had to make a choice, we made the choice exactly according to the DVD already prepared. We thought we were making a choice here. Actually, choice had been put in the DVD before we ever came here. So, what happened? That something that was totally predetermined, totally fixed, began to look like we were making it here, that we were making those choices here. That is why the destiny itself, which was part of our life, one life here, began to function in two different ways. One, those events over which we had no choice, such as the place and time of our birth, we had no choice, such as an accident happening on the road, we had no choice, such as an illness coming upon us, no choice, such as winning a lottery ticket, no choice. But in between these events where we had no choice, we began to have small periods where we thought we had a choice. Excuse me, because of my bad throat. These small periods, gaps in events, gave us the feeling we are making choices. The brain was programmed, completely programmed, to think hard and make the same choice, which was already made. But we thought we are making choices now. So a strange experience came up, called the experience of free will. Free will became a real experience for us, because we began to make choice, thinking we have to choose between A or B, this or that, therefore we have free will. This was a very significant event, because it put the blame for the choice and for making a choice which we classified good, bad or neutral. We ourselves classified. How did we classify? We classified by being placed in a world of other people with whom we interacted,
And by interaction, we were able to feel we are making the choice. This free will that we made put the responsibility for that particular choice on us. Actually, we were responsible because we picked up the DVD. Not somebody else did it. But we were not responsible when we made the choice. We had made it earlier. But it looked like we were making a choice at that very time. Therefore, this law of cause and effect became a law of our own making choices. If we made a good choice, we had the effect of it being rewarded. If we made a bad choice, we had the effect of being punished. So whole system of life, in that one life on this physical universe, became a life of punishment and reward. This was a very important thing, because we began to feel we are responsible for our destiny. In fact, we were, but not at this time. We were responsible for our destiny when we picked up our DVD. We made a choice at that time, actual real choice, but not the choice we were making now. So this led to a strange situation that something already predetermined, already ready to play out, looked like we were making it now. And this had far-reaching implications, because this began to work out in a way that we have to make choices here while we are in the physical world, and these choices will lead to results, good and bad. This led to our having to live more than one life in order to go through the rewards and punishments what we were doing in the only life for which we came. And the one life became extended to several lives. When we picked up our DVD, we were very intelligent. We were not that stupid to pick up bad lives, but some of us are having not so great lives. In fact, none of us are having perfect lives. We are all having lives of ups and downs, some good moments, some bad moments. Where did our intelligence go? Couldn't we pick up something which was all good? We could have and did. Some of us, not all. Those who picked up a DVD containing a life of all good actions, good intentions, got rewarded by not coming into a physical world, but in the astral world, going and enjoying in a universe called heaven. In fact, so many people did that there are many heavens, much bigger than this universe. And those people who picked up those DVDs are having good time there. They are enjoying. Some said, no, we want a thrill. We want to do some bungee jumping. We want to take real thrills in this world. And they picked up some of those events which were terrible. They are also in the astral plane, in the plane where we don't have physical bodies, but we have sensory system. They are sitting in places called hell. Everything has been designed for all kind of choices that we made. This choice to become a human being in a physical world was not easy, because a human being can only be a human being if it makes a choice that has both good and bad, both pap and pun, both good deeds and bad deeds, both rewards and punishments. If you don't have both of them, you can't be a human being. It's designed like that, because there are other universes where you can go if you don't want to make a mixed choice like this. Why did we then not all go to heaven? Why did we decide to come in a mixed life which has good and bad in it, which has reward and punishment in it? We came here because we could also see that being here in one life with our actions, the DVD provided four more lives. And we saw other lives. We saw that maybe we should stay for 5 lives or 10 or 20. Once we are fed up, we should go back home. In the 20th life or the 5th life or whatever life we wanted to check not to go any further, we made a provision to go back home. We wanted to have a real experience, not a shadow experience, not a stage show, not just a movie or something, not designed like a movie, but we wanted to be real. We did some wonderful things to make this life, which was designed to be a movie, a DVD played out, we tried to make it very real. And the best way to do it was not to sit in the audience and watch the movie, but go into the head of one of the characters in the movie and watch it from inside, amongst the actors. So we settled ourselves in one of the actors in the DVD. And that is why we became that one person in this life. We had already seen that this life has good things and bad things, but one day, which is of our determination, after 5 lives, 10 lives, some people wanted to have more experience, a wider experience, different places, different timings, different past time, future time. They all decided that we'll look at, flip the, through the future lives in the same DVD, and we don't want to go here forever. We should have the arrangement to go back home. So we picked those DVDs which in turn of several lifetimes brought a lifetime where we could go back home. And we knew it at that time, that we are picking this DVD by choice because it gives us the pathway to go back home. And the only doorway to go back home was left in this category of a human being. We created many other forms also of life. Plants, trees, insects, birds, all having the same unit of consciousness, all having the same soul, all having different experiences, all based upon the law of cause and effect, all based on karma. But we had the intelligence and the sense that if we want to have a good arrangement to go back home, we should pick up a DVD which at a certain time should provide for our return home. Somebody recommended to me to see a movie called Inception. I don't know if any of you have seen it. An English movie called Inception, in which they show that a person can go into a dream state and change the time factor. That means you can sleep for 10 minutes and create 1 hour of dream. You can then sleep again in the dream to have a second dream, and that 1 hour in the first dream can become 50 years in the third dream. It was a very interesting movie that you can expand time like that. And why I liked it is because that's exactly how we are here. We are in a state of dreaming in which in a non-time instant, we created time. Then in a small time, we went into third dream, fourth dream. We are in the sixth dream. So we have billions of years, trillions of years time available here. It all came up because of our selection. The other interesting thing in that movie was that they had a device in their hand, little totem in their hand, which they could press, they could carry that experience into the dream. When they wanted to wake up, they could use the totem and wake up. We have the same system put up here. We have ourselves designed our way to go back home from inception, before we came. And what was the totem? The totem was, in this case, the appearance in our life of another human being, just like us, no difference, but awake, in consciousness. We are dreaming to be physical. Such a person should be physical, but should be awake. How much awake? Awake all the way to our true home. Not one wakefulness. He should be wakefulness all 6 steps of wakefulness you should have already had and still be a human being with us. We designed that when we want to go back home, such a person should appear in our dream. We are in a wakeful state of dreaming now. And such a person who comes into our life fully awake, that means when he encounters us, when he talks to us, he does not talk from his knowledge gained in this world. He does not talk from what he has remembered. He talks from what he is living. That means he is living simultaneously in the wakeful state in our true home, as well as wakeful state in all the intermediate stages and the physical stage. Such a being is very rare, extremely rare. But for a person who was designed to wake up after certain lifetimes, he is bound to come and meet that person and take that person back to true home. Guaranteed. We made sure. That is why it is not an accident or coincidence that happens. When we are ready to go back home, our readiness has been determined before we came. When we are ready to go back to our true home and have enough of this world, enough of this experience, such a person comes into our life automatically, by coincidence, by accident, not by our seeking, searching. Our searching starts just to show that we are ready to go back home. We can be searching for a whole lifetime. We can be searching for 2 lifetimes. When we are ready, such a person will come into our life. This person we call a perfect living master, a Param Sant Satguru. That term is used for such a person who comes into our life when we are ready to go home, and we had made the arrangement ourselves when he will come. When we are tired of the show, tired of experiencing time, space and this world, and we are ready to go back home, such a person comes into our life. He does not wear any special costume. He does not say, I want to wear white clothes or orange colored, saffron colored clothes or no clothes, therefore I am come to give you some spiritual teaching. Those people come when we are getting ready. Those people tell us something about our true home. But the true person who is going to take us, takes us by surprise, takes us by a coincidence. And we can't find him because he's no different from us. He's born like us, dies like us, eats food like us, falls sick like us, gets treatment like us, marries like us, children like us, responsibilities like us, does jobs like us, make an earning like us. No difference at all. He's not something special. He's just like us, except that we think this physical world is our only reality, and he knows there are several realities, including the ultimate reality of our true home, and he does not know it. He is living it while he is here. Therefore, when such a person speaks to us, he is not speaking from here. He is speaking from our true home. Therefore, he can answer our questions entirely up to our true home. Therefore, in his talk, there never is any perhapses or maybes or speculation. Because he is not trying to say, I learned something, I am telling you. He does not rely upon books. He does not rely upon learning. He relies upon what he is experiencing while he is still here, ordinary human being. That is why we can't find such a human being there like us. We don't know where he is. People who can dress up differently can be identified. They may be good teachers. This person we call perfect living master. In America, we abbreviate everything, say PLM. PLM is just a perfect living master. Perfect living master is not a teacher. There are thousands of teachers teaching us how to meditate, teaching us how to go within yourself where the truth lies, teaching us even the way to our true home. They are teachers. They are gurus. That means teachers. Perfect living master is not a teacher. He comes at a time when we have to go back home, he takes us home. Then who is he? He's a friend of ours, a companion, a friend, a traveler who travels with us to our true home. But when he finds that we need, not we, our mind, well, our mind needs to be taught, simply because mind has been indoctrinated that you can't get anything without your struggle, without learning something. Everything in this universe is achieved by learning, working, struggling, finding it. So we try, our mind tries to place the same rules on finding our true home, and those rules don't apply. Why don't these rules apply? The rules don't apply because our true home is way beyond our mind. And all struggle, all teaching and learning are with the mind. All effort is with the mind. You can't use something that is responsible for effort to go beyond it. Therefore, learning, teaching, books, lectures do not take us to our true home, no matter how eloquent and how great they might be. They are all satisfying our mind. Our true home is beyond the mind. Mind was created just for an experience. That is why these perfect living masters, only for the sake of our mind and to separate us from our mind, that the mind and soul are not the same thing. We are thinking not with the soul. We are speaking not with the soul. We are meditating not with the soul. We are using the mind for all these things. And our true home is beyond the mind. Therefore, no amount of learning, no amount of struggle, no amount of effort can ever take us to our true home. And nobody has ever gone with these methods of the mind. How does this work then? To go beyond the mind, it must be something beyond the mind that pulls us beyond the mind. Therefore, these ordinary people who have come awakened with the awareness of their true home, when they come here, they don't use the method of teaching except for their mind for some time. They try to teach because our mind wants it. We are not identifying ourselves separate from the mind. Therefore, they become temporary teachers. But what do they actually do? They actually do something which can only happen beyond the mind. Our soul has its own functions, own characteristics, own attributes. What are the attributes of total consciousness and our individuated consciousness for the soul? What comes directly from our soul, which cannot come from our mind? Three things. One, the experience of love, being pulled by love, no matter what, where it is, with whom it is, what experience we have, to be pulled by love is a spiritual experience always. The experience of knowledge without time, knowing something without using time, which we sometimes call intuitive knowledge, flash of knowledge, gut feeling. We use many words. No thought has gone into it. You don't think and say this is the truth. It just comes. We say, I know it. How do you know it? I don't know how I know it, but I know it. That kind of intuitive knowledge comes directly from the soul, not from the mind, because no time is involved. Mind cannot function except in time. Even the smallest thought takes time. Intuition takes no time. It is sudden, spontaneous. That is why there are separate functions of the soul and the mind. The soul does not need time and intuitively experiences love, intuitive knowledge, and a state of bliss or a state of utter happiness, which is not divided, not divisible into happiness and unhappiness. Therefore, we don't use the word happiness for the state, we use the word bliss. We don't have proper words for that state of experience, but we distinguish it from happiness and unhappiness, which are pairs of opposites. Pleasure and pain, pairs of opposites. That state of bliss does not require any opposite. These three things, our state of that bliss, our state of being actual embodiment of love, our state of intuitive knowledge, complete knowledge of everything, belongs to our soul and to our totality of our soul, where we are one in our true home, from where the many came up. But the faculty of thinking, faculty of evaluating, faculty of judgment, faculty of dividing things into good and bad, this faculty belongs to the mind. Totally divided. The two things are separate. We have merged our soul, which has the power to make anything alive. We have put that power of life into the mind and made the mind into an independent entity working for us. It was designed to be like that. It was like a computer. Unless you empowered it, unless you put power into it, it wouldn't work. The mind is just like a computer. The input, output processing is very similar. In fact, we almost copy. When we make computers, we copy our own mind. So the mind is designed differently and works only in time and space. Soul does not. So these functions are separate, but we experiencing a physical world through sense perceptions and through this body do not make a distinction between our mind and our soul. Our journey to our true home has to be performed by the soul, not by the mind. The mind is a machine we have to leave behind. All effort must be made with the mind. Then the only way to go beyond the mind is to use these three functions. The function of love, intuitive knowledge and bliss. Where do we see this in this physical world? Can we see it here? Yes, all of us have it. So long as we are alive, we have a soul, therefore we all have it. But we intermingle it with the mind's way of thinking and begin to think it's thinking that's creating love, thinking that's creating knowledge, thinking that's creating everything. It's not. It's creating very limited experiences here. Therefore, when we say we are tired of the system, we don't want to be in the system of birth, rebirth, continuous reincarnations, and we don't want to be here anymore, and we have designed to meet somebody in a particular life who is awakened with all these levels of creation, including our true home, in that moment, that person becomes our friend and pulls us by his love, not coming from the physical world, not coming from the astral world, not coming from the mental or causal world, but coming from our true home. That love is different. When we experience that love, even sitting in the physical world, such a person has come, when we experience that love, it pulls us. It does not pull our mind. It pulls us, the soul. Soul says there is something happening. The mind is arguing, how can it happen? Mind has a rationality in it, the reasons, doubts. Mind is a very good machine, programmed to have doubts. Why was a doubt put into a mind as a program? Because if there was no doubt, anybody could take us for a ride. We would never be able to check what is true, what is not true. Therefore, doubt was necessary. That you must doubt, question, and get over it before you can say what is true. It was a good device to put a doubt into the functioning of the mind. Doubt leads to another thing. It leads to fear. Now remember, doubt and fear in our life only comes from our mind. It does not come from our soul. Our soul has no fear. His soul has no doubt. We are the soul, not the mind. We are using the mind, but when we use doubt and fear, we go through a strange experience of a struggle between love, pure love from such kant, from our true home coming, pulling us, and the mind saying, I am doubtful and afraid. A natural consequence of that experience. And we all go through it. When we go through this, the pull of the love coming from our true home, being expressed through a human being like ourselves, with us, ultimately overrides the mind. And we put the mind aside and we are pulled by love beyond the mind, and a journey to our true home begins. Predesigned, predetermined by us for our own going back to home. Good method. Actually, if you look at the whole system of creation, how from consciousness we put on space and time through mind, how we put on divided experience into sense perceptions, how we put on these heavy costumes of physical bodies, looks very perfect. If you view from the top, it's the most perfect system that you could ever see. I can tell you, if any one of you were shown the whole picture and asked to please retouch it, retune it to make it better, you won't be able to do it. The perfection is in the total picture, not in the parts. We see parts and we see imperfection. Therefore, the mind and its world becomes imperfect, and our own true home becomes perfect. We are assembled here. Why are we here? Why am I coming and sharing these things with you? What is my job? Why am I coming here talking to you? Who authorized me to come and talk to you? What right have I to tell you these things? These are questions to me. And my answer is, in this physical world, a certain person like ourselves came into my life by accident. Accident of birth, accident of my parents being somewhere, purely accidental. A person whose picture you see sitting next to me, he came into my life. This is the picture of my master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji. He came into my life and I thought he was a very saintly guy. I particularly liked his beard, the white beard. Looked very nice. He's a great looking person. He walked like a king. I liked that too. I liked him as a person. He spoke with authority, which also impressed me. He is speaking with authority of something which I can't see. And I wanted to see. He said, I will tell you how to see it. I said, why should I believe you? He said, don't believe me. Do you believe that you exist? I said, naturally I exist. He said, why do you believe that? How do you believe that you exist? I said, I believe because I'm experiencing right now I exist. He says, what if the experience of going inside is the same? I said, then I will believe you. If the experience is as good as my experience of being here, a being, if I know I'm a being and nobody can question it, nobody can question we are beings because we are experiencing it. If the experience, I said, if you can show me an experience as satisfying, as certain, as the experience of being here, I'll believe you. Otherwise, I won't. And he said, very good. You should never believe anything which you haven't experienced. That made me very happy. That he himself, from whom I'm trying to find out something, he's himself telling me, don't believe anything, not even your guru, not even your master, unless you have experienced something. And then he said, only believe that which you have experienced, no more. If you have more experience, believe that. But believe only what is experience of certainty, not experience of doubt. No speculation, no imagination, real experience. These kind of things from this man impressed me. And I said, it's worthwhile giving a trial, at least one step. That is why I followed him. And today I can tell you, toward the end of my life, I'm telling you, I'll be 90 in two months. So I can't say I'm a beginner in this game. What he told me, how to meditate, how to do things, was almost 80 years ago. That's a lifetime for most of you. So I am telling you from that experience that I would not believe him but for what I would experience. And that was his main theme of his teaching, that don't believe anything unless you have seen and experienced yourself. He gave another example, a good one. When we go to sleep and have a dream, we forget where we are sleeping. We forget whether we are in a bed or where. In the dream, we are running around. We are going places, meeting people. And even if we come to know in a dream that it is a dream, do we really know? Many of you must have had a dream in which you knew that you were dreaming. I had a few, and most of my friends tell me they had that also, that in the dream they suddenly came to feel this is a dream. What did they do when they found out? They told everybody in the dream, you know it's a dream. And then they woke up. There was nobody to tell. That means they were telling the truth without experiencing it. Because if they were experiencing it, they would know there is nobody there. They are sleeping in a bed. That kind of awareness, knowledge, is not knowledge of certainty. But knowledge in a dream state. A knowledge in the same state in which we are trying to check if it is a dream or not. That does not give you real knowledge. Now supposing you wake up from sleep. Your eyes are closed. You are lying in your bed. And you know you are awake. Do you ever open your eyes to see, am I awake? Do you ever pinch yourself, is this body an awake body or still I am dreaming? Nobody does that. Supposing when you wake up in the morning and 10 people come and say, you are still dreaming. You do not believe them. You believe your own experience. There is no experience greater than the experience of wakefulness. If you are sleeping and you wake up, the awareness that you are awake comes instantly. It does not require any checkup, does not require any evidence from outside. It's this experience of certainty. What gives it the experience of certainty? If you really examine, when you wake up, what makes you certain, absolutely certain, you are awake, is the fact you can remember that you went to sleep. That's what happens. While you're still in the bed, no movement, you are awake, you remember, now I'm in the bed, that's where I slept. The link with the previous experience at the same level of wakefulness comes back instantly, and there is no doubt about that experience in anybody's mind. Nobody has ever questioned it. These are the kind of experiences which have certainty. If you did not remember, when you woke up, you never remember that you slept. You would never know what is real, what is not real. But the moment you wake up and you know, I slept, I am awake, because I am in the same bed, I am in the same house, same place, therefore I remember, this is true, I am awake. Anybody can tell you, 1,000 people can come and say, you are not awake, you are still sleeping. You say, no, I know I am awake. That certainty comes if you awake further from this physical state into an astral state. When you wake up there, the certainty is identical. His teaching was to have that kind of certainty. Nothing less than that. This is a practical method of finding out who we are, where we belong, where is our true home. It's not a theoretical concept. It's not a model that we are setting up. It could be like that. It's not like that. It's something anybody can verify and experience. By anybody, I mean any human being, without any distinction of nationality, of color of the skin, the age, the gender, makes no difference. It is an essential part of a human being to have this built into his system of awareness, system of consciousness, to have the ability of certainty by waking up. Nothing can ever give you more certainty, according to my experience, based on the teachings, than the experience of waking up to a different level. This is not something that we are just believing. Just believing is called blind faith. There is no place for blind faith, the teaching that I am referring to. The method of awakening to the highest level of your true home does not require any blind faith at all. Religion requires blind faith. Today, all religions require blind faith. Somebody said something, believe it. Have you seen it? No. Believe it. Why? That's your religion. Religions were not made for that. I was in a university in the United States, Harvard University, very well known. And I went to study on a scholarship to study economics, because I had never studied economics in my life. I was a science student, physics, chemistry, biology, I was studying something else. Suddenly I went up on a fellowship to study economics, administration, general administration, economic development. I was studying different subjects. My interest lay in studying religion. So on the side, I was studying 11 major religions of the world. They had a huge library called the Widener Library. And I studied those religions. I studied for the sake of finding out there must be something common in all the religions. I found a great difference between what the founders of the religion said and what the practitioners of the religion were doing. The founders of the religion said everything that you have to really find has to be found inside you. All religions, without exception. The practitioners of religion said, you have to perform these rituals outside, these ceremonies, to stay in the religion. The subject of going within to find reality was common and existed in the teachings of the founders of those religions. But the practicing people who were administering that religion were not bothered about that at all. They were bothered about what was happening outside. What kind of rituals you have to perform, and they were different from religion to religion, making religions different from each other. Teachings were one. So I thought that they have forgotten. Religious leaders, after the founders passed away, seem to have forgotten what the founders said, and they are now following external ceremonies, external rituals, external things all the time, and advocating only outside things. I said, maybe there may be something else common even in their outside worship. Maybe they have love in common. Maybe they have bliss, talking of bliss in common. Maybe they are talking of intuitive knowledge in common. I could not find it. And none of them who were practicing religion were talking of these things. I said, there must be something which is common to all religions. And you know what it turned out to be? I found one thing common in all religions. Each one said, we are the only true religion, all others are fake. This was the only common thing. How we divided ourselves? Here spiritual teachings came from religion and religion divided us completely. Spiritual teachings were completely uniting us, that there is no difference. As human beings, where we are born, who we believe in, where we are, what food we eat, what dress we wear, what language we speak, there's no difference in the ultimate home, true home. And here, the practitioners of those very teachings are saying we are all different, we are the right ones, you are not. They all said there's only one God. But they said, we have it, you don't. They divided God amongst themselves. They divided the Creator among themselves. So these are things that have helped us to divide ourselves. Nobody likes division, but something in us likes division. That's our mind. Did you know mind likes division? Soul hates division. Soul likes unity. Soul likes to be one. Mind likes to be separate. Mind is constantly separating us. It not only separates from us from each other, separates us through religion, language, nationality. It also separates us from our own self. It separates us from our soul. It's the greatest separatist mechanism built into us. Just for the sake of having a different experience, we are using an instrument that delights itself in separation. What is the method the mind works to get knowledge, to function? It breaks things into pieces, like a little child. Small child give a toy, child doesn't enjoy the toy, likes to break. How does it work? Mind is a toy breaker. Mind is a concept breaker. Mind is a thought breaker. Mind is a breaker all the way. It uses a method which we in philosophy call analysis. All minds are analytical. They like to break things, look into parts and see what is the truth. By breaking, you never find the truth. Truth is only found by joining. Take an example. Here is the photograph of my master. I love to see his photograph. He was my master. Beautiful. Wonderful face, nice beard, white beard. Some radiance I find in his face. Now supposing I take this photograph out from its frame and I use my scissors to cut it to 1 square inch pieces, and I put all those pieces on the table, I can say the picture, photograph of my master is on the table. Do you know you can see those pieces 1,000 times, you will never see that face, because you broke it up. Do you know the truth is one, unbroken? Lies in our true home, lies within us. But we divide it through our mind into here and there, into now and then, scissors of time and space. We can never experience the whole. Therefore, we can never understand the truth. The only way to know the ultimate truth is to join everything together, which is only possible when you go to your true home. Beyond the mind, beyond this scissor cutter, this cutter of things into pieces. And that is why we say it's imperfect world, because we see little pieces. I show those pieces of my master's picture. I say, see, the whole picture is here, not part of it. The whole picture is lying on the table. And you keep on seeing piece by piece. I don't see the master. It's not there. We deny something that is on the table because it is cut up. Our life has been cut up. The physical life, for the sake of experience, was cut up into pieces of days and nights, of months and years, of here and there, of India and America, of all kinds of cutting up. That is why, while we are here, we cannot see the truth. We are too separated. This separation ends completely when we go to our true home and discover we were only one totality of consciousness, not even broken. Sometimes people give an example that our real self was one big ocean, big sea, full of waves and water, and we are now tiny drops from that ocean. Somehow we got separated. And we were flung far away into this world and other worlds. And now our job is to find a guru, to find a teacher, learn from him how we as a little drop have to fly back and go and merge back into the ocean. This was the definition of spiritual path given to me when I was young. I reacted very badly to this definition. I said, if I am really a drop, I shine with the sun, create a rainbow on myself, have such a wonderful feeling of being a drop. Now you people are telling me, the gurus are telling me, now fly back all the way to your own origin, the ocean, and then do what? That merged in it. I said, if I merge in the ocean, I lose all my identity. I lose my rainbow effect. I lose who I am. What does the ocean gain? One more drop, it doesn't care. What will one drop make any difference to the ocean? This spiritual path is all losing, losing game. That's what I thought. I did not know that this was not the correct position at all. Indeed, we are drops of consciousness. But we never left the ocean. That was a mistake. We thought we actually left the ocean. No. We were drops in the ocean, are still in the ocean, were always in the ocean. All we lost was our awareness that we are the ocean. We got an awareness, a small drop in the ocean. Spiritual path was not a drop flying somewhere to merge anywhere. The spiritual path was to increase the awareness of the ocean. I am not that small. I am bigger part of the ocean. I am more bigger part of the ocean. I am a much bigger drop than I thought. I am the ocean. That is spiritual path. The spiritual path is to discover your oneness. It's not flying somewhere to merge anywhere. We are already there. Somebody said, how long is the journey to our true home? I said, not very long. What is it, a few miles? Few kilometers? I said, no, not at all. Because it all happens in the head. He said, then is it just a few inches? Not really. It's millimeter, part of a millimeter. He said, not exactly. It's a billionth part of a millimeter. I said, not. Then how far is the journey? We are already there. We are the destination. We have not gone anywhere. We lost the awareness of it. This is a game of knowing and aware, being aware. We just shrunk our awareness to individuality and became the many within the one, not outside. That is why the soul yearns to be one with its own totality, which is the reality and is only one. When we all say the Creator is only one, if He is only one and He knows everything, He is present everywhere, that means we are all inside the Creator. Supposing we walk out of our God, our Ishwar, Allah, whoever we are calling our totality, we walk out, He can't remain total, He can't remain God, and we become independent of God. Then the whole definition of God being omnipresent, omnipotent, omniscient fails. This is very good definition, by the way, of our ultimate self, our ultimate totality of one, that the ultimate totality is omnipresent naturally, because nothing has gone out of it, everything has happened within it. Omnipotent, yeah, all the power is there, because the whole power of creation has come from there. Omniscient, knowing everything. That's the most important part. The totality knows everything. If the totality knows everything, where is our free will? How can we make a decision unknown to the Creator? The Creator is supposed to know everything in advance. Creator is supposed to have all the knowledge. Can we then have independent awareness of our own? We can't have free will based on this definition of the Creator. And yet we experience it. Every day we experience it. There was a friend of mine in the university, Harvard University, and he used to discuss these subjects with me, metaphysics and all. And he said, on telephone one day in the morning. He said, "Eureka, I have found out. I have found out we cannot have free will. Everything is predetermined." That is a big question in his mind. Do we have free will or not? What bothered him most was that if we don't have free will, how can we be punished for something that somebody else is deciding? If God knows everything, He should be punished. He set up the whole thing, He knows everything. Why are we being punished for our karma? What is karma then? Big question in his mind. So one day he found out that we have no free will because God must know everything. So he called me. He said, "I found out. We have no free will, no choice." I said, "Will you please come to my apartment and we'll discuss this a little more." So I played a little trick on him. I took out a tray and put 3 cups on it. One with tea, one with coffee, and one empty. When he came in, I said, "My friend, would you like tea or coffee or nothing? I've got all 3 on the tray. And don't use your free will, you don't have it." He got stunned. I said, "No, you can't make a choice, you have no free will. Tell me, you'll have tea or coffee or nothing?" And he said, "You have shocked my total knowledge. You're making me choose." I said, "I am going to prove to you that you say you have no free will. I'll tell you, you cannot escape from using free will. You have so much free will that even if you say I have no free will, you said it out of free will. You could have said I have or not have. We are using free will all the time, every day. How do you say we have no free will?" He said, "You're shocked by true knowledge. I got true knowledge. God is omniscient. God knows everything. So He must know what I am going to decide. And now you say, you decide whether you want to have tea or coffee. You broken my big knowledge with tea, coffee, 2 cups." So, having shocked him, I said, "Now I'll take your stand that you really had no free will. I'll prove to you, take the devil's side now." I said, "When I say take tea or coffee, how do you decide? Your mind works, says, okay, tea, coffee, and then suddenly you say, I'll take coffee. When you say that, with your mind making a choice between tea and coffee, what happens inside your head? You say, I think I should have, okay, I'll take coffee. When you said that, to say that, the factors that went into the play of your choice making were only 2. One, hereditary factors. Your father liked coffee, grandfather liked coffee. Somebody liked coffee which went into your DNA, into your genetic system. And therefore you had a predisposition. Because of your parents, because of grandparents, because of your heritage, because of your ancestry, you could only choose coffee because you couldn't change them. They've already gone. You can't change your parents, you can't change your grandfather, you can't change anybody. Therefore, if their effect is coming, making you use coffee, then that alone would take you only coffee. The second set of factors that could make you choose between tea and coffee is what you have been exposed to. Maybe in the university you lived amongst coffee drinkers, you got the coffee of taste and you began to say, yes, I like coffee. These were environmental factors through which environment you passed and they made you like coffee. I said, do you realize these are the only 2 factors that are responsible for your taking coffee? No third. And both of them were completely fixed when you made the choice. You could neither change the environment you passed through, nor could you change your hereditary system. Therefore, you could only choose coffee by using your brain of free will. I'm telling scientifically, no metaphysics involved, no spiritual belief system. The scientific fact, that when we make a choice, there is no other factor that helps us to make a choice except these two. Therefore, since these two choices are always the same, fixed what has already happened, therefore you can never change it. Therefore you have no choice. You have no choice but to say God. This I am saying based upon scientific principle. I can also tell you religious principle. Since you discovered this by believing in God as omniscient, I'll give you a religious formula also. What's the formula for explaining your free will through religion? Formula is, if we are all within God and we can't leave God and make him unwhole, make him incomplete, we have to be within God to make him totality, total. If you're within God, how can your will be separate from God's will? Therefore, God will plays through you, even according to religion. That God's will alone makes you, as part of that, to choose certain things. Therefore, even religiously speaking, if you study properly, things are already predetermined, known to the ultimate truth of which you are a part. But when we sit here, why were we given this choice? Why should we feel that we have to make choices and then suffer for them, then regret, then feel guilt? Why did I do that? I should not have done that. Why do we have this guilt which makes us so miserable? And most of the misery of our life in this world is consisting of going back into the past, remembering good and bad things we have done, and never looking what is going to happen in the future. Why did we get into this trap? Reason was simple. We are not separated from God. We have never been separated. God would not be God if we got separated. We are still units of consciousness within totality of consciousness we call God. Therefore, in order to experience our godliness, to experience our divinity, we as human beings have been made in the image of the Creator. And this statement you can find in other religions also, that man has been made in the image of the Creator, of God. When they say he is made in the image, does it mean God has eyes and ears? Certainly not. God is a creative power. Then how is man like the Creator? Only in this, God has real will with which the whole show came into being. And man experiences that within the total will and thinks, I am making the same thing. That's the only similarity. God's will is real. Man's will is an experience, but works within God's will, never goes out of it. These are understandings of the nature of creation, the nature of our own self, which are verifiable by any of us by going to the source. The source is nowhere outside. The whole experience of this physical world, of astral world, even of Sachkhand, even true home, is all a created experience. The only reality is the experiencer, not the experience, no matter what. The source is the experiencer. The source is the self, the ultimate self. This nature of self is what makes us who we are. The self is our own totality, creator, creative power. It becomes the many within itself, and parts of the many find themselves, the totality within themselves, they never left it. We go into experiences of this physical world, world of space and time, the self remains the same. We go to sleep and have a dream, and the self remains the same. There was a Chinese philosopher, Fahin. He had a dream. Very beautiful dream he had. He felt he was a butterfly. And he was flying in the garden. And flowers were so strange. light and color was coming out of those flowers. He had never seen them in this world. He said, this must be heaven. This must be where we really are. And he, as a butterfly, was flapping his wings, going from flower to flower, and saying, I have found reality. And then he woke up and began to think, that was certainly more real than this. Then am I actually a butterfly? Am I really a butterfly who's now dreaming that I am a philosopher? Or am I a philosopher who had a dream, very surreal, strange dream, where I thought I was a butterfly? So he told his friends, he said, I had a very strange dream. In that dream, I felt I was a butterfly. His friend said, what are you, nonsense are you talking? You're not a butterfly, you're a man. You shouldn't say you were a butterfly, say you saw a butterfly. He said, I never saw a butterfly. I was flying. They were my wings. That was my body. They said, how could it be you? Didn't you realize that you are a man, not a butterfly? He said, I looked through the eyes of my butterfly body. It was I who was flying as a butterfly. And then he realized that the self, which was the man, or the same self that was a butterfly, will be the same self, no matter what form he takes. No matter if there is no form, it will still be the same. It will be the same form where you will find a totality that God is the same form, the same self. This is so important to know, that at no time can you have any experience anywhere in any universe, at any level of consciousness, where the self changes. The self is unchanged always. Everything else changes except the self. If we want to follow a definition of reality, that which does not change, then the only thing we know which does not change at all is the self. The unit of consciousness or the totality of consciousness that is having changing experiences all the time. The experiencer never changes. Therefore, if you want to find true reality, the ultimate reality that never changes, the ultimate reality is your own self. Just for the sake of experience, you put on a costume. Supposing a barber in the shop says, we are going to do Ram Leela. Come, you become Ram. And he dresses up like Ram and he's acting in Ram Leela or on any stage show. And he says, I am Ram. He's not Ram, he's a barber. He's the same barber. He's just acting as Ram. He's just taken a temporary role as Ram. But he can confuse himself that I am actually Ram. But when he gets off stage, he finds I am the same barber working there. When we come to this stage of creation, stage of life that we are here in, we are thinking we are that which costume we are wearing for this show. We are thinking we are the costume, the body. We give a name, our parents give a name, somebody gives a name to this body, we think that's us. The body gives birth to a child, they say it's my child. It's not your child, the child of your body, your costume. Say, this is my house. It's not your house. The house of your body. When you leave your body, house is no longer yours. You're somewhere else. We forget. This self is not a costume we are wearing. And we are wearing such thick costumes. Physical costume is very thick. We have to take this costume off to find we are not costume. Otherwise, we keep on identifying ourselves with the physical body. This is us, this is me, this is myself. So physical body dies, self does not. How could you be the physical body? Inner body dies, maybe later. The body that has sense perception, that can see, touch, taste, smell, which you can all do by closing your eyes, and you can still see, touch, taste, smell, you call it imagination. It's still you. is your own self having that imagination. That has a much longer life. That you die, that still lives. How do you know that? How am I saying that? That when you will die, the power to see, touch, taste, smell will still be there? On what basis am I saying that? The basis is that physical death of a physical body can be copied, can be simulated, can be done while we are living in the body and have the same experience. Death is merely the absence of experience of physical body. That goes. The inner self is there. We can do it now without dying, which we call dying while living. How do we do that? Simple method. If you say, I am not the body, I live in my body, I wear my body, then where are you living? Where are you saying this from? Where does this thought come from that maybe I am something inside and not in the body? Is it coming from your hands? No. From your legs and feet? No. From your heart? No. Where is it coming from when you are saying to yourself in your mind, I am not my body, I am living in the body? Where do you say that from? From the head. Which place in the head? Center. How do I know it? How can you know it? Look in there. We've never looked inside. We use our eyes to look outside. If we want to use our inner eyes, eyes of imagination, we still want to look outside. We feed ourselves with everything that is outside. Have we ever tried to say, let me with my inner eyes see what is behind my eyes? Have we thought of that? It can be done. We have done it. Many people have done it. You can all do it. If you do this and say, who am I? In my head, that is thinking. Who am I that can imagine? Who am I that can put attention on something? Who am I, conscious being? If you just think of that, and where am I? You will find there's a space inside the head, right behind the eyes, between the ears. You want in more technical anatomy language, it's where the pituitary body and the pineal gland is well protected, the most protected part of our life, of our body. It's situated right in the center. It's on the top of medulla oblongata. If you want to go into technical physiology and anatomy, I can tell you that too. You don't need to study physiology. You can close your eyes, say, where am I? You'll find out. Supposing you were to put your entire attention upon where you are and place yourself there, what will happen? Over time, you won't know where your hands and feet are. After a while, you won't know where your legs have gone. You're putting your attention all in the head. After a while, you won't know even where your body is. But you will know you are there, because you're still talking to yourself and saying these things. You're able to see, you're able to touch, able to have all experiences, because imagination still provides you all those. What kind of self is that? That is all sensory perceptions, and there is no body awareness at all. You have found your inner self. After that, you will never say, this body is myself. That was myself living in this body, using this body. First step in discovering that you are not this self. Not discovering the self yet. Just in discovering this is not yourself. Now, what I just explained to you, that by putting attention here, you can have the experience of death. I say this because if you have seen people dying, terminal illness, where they don't die as suddenly as not being able to be observed, but you can observe them dying, you will see their experience is identical to this. Their hands and feet die first. They don't know where they are. Their legs and arms die next. Their torso dies from the bottom up. They're still speaking to us. They're talking, I am flying in the sky. They're not flying. They just lost the sensation, the lower part of their body. They speak till they come to this place, they get choked. They can still see, you see their eyes moving, looking at you. They go up, the brain dies, they are dead. Nothing is left in the body. The experience itself is identical to the experience of putting your attention inside and withdrawing support and only looking inside, only putting attention there. It's like dying while living. Great step in discovering the body is not yourself. That is the inner self which you discovered as imagination, can still see in imagination, can touch, taste, do all those things. Do the same thing again with the inner body. Go behind the eyes of that inner self, the imaginary self. It has eyes. Go behind the eyes. Think only of that. Put all attention there. You'll become unaware of all your sense perceptions. You are still there, very much there. So much there that you can see exactly what your destiny was, how DVDs were made, and how it functions. How building blocks of these experiences came about from there. Many people have seen that. Whoever has practiced that has seen that. It has not mattered at all whether that person was Christian, Hindu, Muslim or anything. Everybody, no matter what, being a human being, saw the same thing. You realize that imaginary self was not you. The thinking self was you. You are still thinking. After that, you can't experiment anymore. But you can wish for more. You can seek more. You can say, I want more. That you can say. With the same mind, you can say these things. I want more. I want to know what is behind my thinking. Who am I? That you can say. And if you say that, a human being whom we call the PLM, the Perfect Living Master, appears and draws you with love, not from outside, which was temporary, draws you inside, beyond your thinking power. As you leave the mind behind, you find, I was consciousness, I was soul, and I am having a friend, another soul, and we are traveling together till we merge and find we are the same one. That's a spiritual journey. That is the self all the time. It just took on different experiences. Self never changed. Self is the reality. Socrates said, know thyself. That's the reality. If you can know that self, you found God and you found everything. Therefore, this practice, which I learned from this beautiful gentleman with the white beard, enables us to have that experience. Part of it, we can try and do with our own effort. And the rest of it, he can do for us. Can a human being outside of ourselves do much for us? Especially if he's old. This guy was old. Can this man do something for me as a man? He himself needed some support, medicines or something for treatment. What as a man can he do for me? Not much. He can talk to me nicely and I can feel very pulled by his love and I can say, I admire you and I love you. I can say that. But he can't be too helpful to me. Then what will be helpful? If I see that he is being seen outside and is not outside. When does that happen? When does that strange experience come that you are seeing somebody outside and you realize he's not outside? You are projecting him outside and he is inside. When does that happen? That happens when he outside says, I accept you as my friend. You are now my friend. I have come to take you back home. He says outside and pulls from inside. not only pulls from inside, becomes visible inside, becomes visible in the same form he's outside, except that we love him even more than we could love outside. And we discover first time that who we call a perfect living master is never outside, is always inside. We don't see inside. We close our eyes, it's darkness. Therefore, he comes outside to be seen. If we were practitioners already of seeing inside, we would see him inside and then he would be appearing outside. We don't see inside, so he becomes a friend outside. And then when we see him inside, he is a friend 24/7, outside once in a while, divided by space and time. How often can we meet the outside person? How often can we go and see? Inside, always there. That's the beginning of our spiritual journey. And that happens when that outside person determines, or we through him determine, that we are ready to go back home. He says, are you ready? Yes, I am ready. Let's go together. This process of saying, are you ready? And you're saying, yes, I am ready. And he is saying, let's go home together, has been given different names. The most common name is initiation, Namdan, Diksha. They are most common names of that particular relationship. When that perfect living master comes and says, all right, I accept you, he makes it formal by saying, I give you initiation. Mind likes that, I've got something. If the mind were not in the way, he won't even say that. He'll just take you home. Mind wants proof all the time. He says, okay, the proof is I say, all right, you're my friend, I initiate you. Initiation is the beginning of a new life, because you started your journey home. How long should we wait after this event takes place called initiation, when we actually start experiencing our pathway home? Is it just a statement that he says you are initiated, it's enough, or something else should happen? A lot happens. A lot happens inside. A lot happens in our mind. A lot happens in our universal mind, from where we picked up our individual mind. What happens? Now, this may be a belief system, so I am saying don't accept it. Listen to it as a possible explanation. What happens? What happens is that our destiny that is made here, which is creating all the events of life here, is created for future lifetimes by our intention in free will. The experience of free will determines our attention used for that free will, and that determines our next life. We make so many decisions. Don't act upon all of them. You say, I hate that man, I want to kill him. Karma created. No, I don't want to kill him. Another karma created. First good one, first bad one, next good one. Have they wiped each other out? No. You'll be punished for the first, rewarded for the second. This is a beauty. People who worship Lord Krishna, they say Krishna was avatar. Even Vishnu's avatar. He came with full knowledge, even as a human being. And even as a child, he spoke things which no child could speak except one with knowledge of something beyond. He had a friend, small friend, whose name was Udo. Krishna and Udo both used to go taking care of cows of the village. And when the cows went to the pastures and ate their grass, these people chatted with each other. One day, this is history, I'm quoting from there. One day, an ant was crawling, small little ant was crawling. Chunti, And Krishna saw that. And he said, Udo, I want to tell you something. The nature of karma, which creates us, is very strange. People sing this line. When Krishna was born, I went there and I saw people working in the farm, working in the gardens. They would gather together in the evening and sing a song. The words were, Udo karman ki gat nyari se, in that language, in that dialect. The nature of karma is very strange. As a boy, a young boy is telling Udo. Then he explains. He says, look at this ant crawling in front of us. This grand ant, because of his good karma, was at one time Brahma, the creator of this universe. Another time, he was the lord of one of the large heavens, where they say the lord is called Indra. He was Indra and he was Brahma. And because of the great good deeds he did, he became Brahma and Indra, and because of bad deeds, he's become an ant today. Don't underestimate the power of karma. Karma does not remove any bad or good karma. Both stay there. People have had karma where they, after death, went to heaven and hell, one after the other. This is the nature of karma. It's a big trap. The biggest trap, that you cannot atone for the karma. You can't say, I did something bad, so let me do a lot of charity, let me do a lot of good things to wipe it out. No. It punished for the first, rewarded for the second. What does this lead to? It leads to the fact that you cannot get out of karma by playing karma. The game is endless by itself. And that is why we get trapped into this and can't get out. The only way to get out from the cycle of birth and rebirth because of karma, the only way to get out permanently, forever, is to go beyond where karma exists. And all karma exists only in the mind and nowhere beyond. There is no karma on our soul. Never was, never will be. When we identify ourselves and become the mind and the senses and the body, we become subject to karma. Remove yourself from there. It can be done by withdrawal of your own attention to yourself, real self. You can go beyond the mind if you have the assistance of a perfect living master pulling you from beyond the mind. That's what they come for. This information I'm sharing with you is at this time only information. I want it to be your experience. Therefore, practice. Many of you, I know, are initiated by perfect living masters. Have you seen all this I'm talking about? No. Why? How come you have all the secret with you? You got the real ticket to your true home. You got initiated, naam daan, you got. Why aren't you having the experiences I'm explaining to you? Because you take this world to be the only reality. You're involved in it. Your priorities are all in this world. This is the most important thing. We will do meditation when we get time. We got initiation, but you know, we are very busy. Busy with what? Busy with something that is a trap for you. You are busying yourself to stay in the trap. You are singing and dancing in a trap. Let me wind up this statement with a little story. This is serious stuff, I know. Heavy stuff, what we call heavy stuff. So lighten it up with a little story. Once upon a time, that's how stories begin, you know. Once upon a time, there was a merchant, a sodagar in India. He used to go to Africa for import and export business. He used to take some silks or something from India and buy cashew nuts and other nuts and something they brought back to India. So trading, import and export. When he was in Africa on one visit, he passed through a forest, a jungle, where he saw a lot of parrots. And the parrots were beautiful. So he decided to take one parrot with him to India. So he bought a cage and he grabbed one parrot, put him in the cage and brought him to India. The parrot grew in the cage. He would give the parrot best food. You know what is the best food for parrots? Chilies, green and red chilies, mirch, they love it. And churi, where you put with this some flour and you put sugar and gud and all that, make a sweet thing. The parrots love this. So his parrots loved the churi, loved the chilies, and he taught him how to sing new songs. Parrot danced and sang, very happy. Next year, when this merchant was going back to Africa, he asked his parrot. He said, "Mr. Parrot, I am going back to your homeland from where I brought you. Do you want to send any message to the other parrots?" And the parrot said, "Yes. Tell them I am enjoying my churi and my chilies and dancing and singing in this beautiful cage. I am having a very good time." So the merchant went to Africa. After finishing his business, he went to the same forest and he said, "Come on, parrots, I have a message for you. Do you remember I took one parrot with me to my own house?" And they all assembled. He said, "That parrot has sent a message for you. He is enjoying his churi and his chilies and dancing and singing in that cage. Very happy." On hearing this, one older looking parrot sitting on a branch of a tree got tears in his eyes and he fell down dead. He said, "Oh foolish merchant, you might not have realized this parrot must have been very close to the parrot I took home, and that is why he could bear this message and he died." Saddened by this event, he came back to India and told the parrot in the cage, "Look, I conveyed your message that you are enjoying your churi and chili and singing and dancing in the cage. I conveyed your message. But there was one parrot, senior looking parrot, who could not bear to hear this message. He got tears in his eyes and he fell down dead." Upon hearing this, the parrot in the cage got tears in his eyes and fell down dead. "It's a foolish merchant. If that parrot could not stand this message, why did you convey this one?" Anyway, parrot had died, so he opened the cage and threw the dead parrot out, regretting what he had done. When he threw the parrot out, parrot opened his wings and flew up. And he sat on top of the wall. And the merchant said, "You aren't dead?" He says, "No, nor is the other parrot dead. He was only sending a message to me through you. And his message was, if you want to get out of the cage, die while living." And the story they made up to show the parrot story. I'll break for now. And I'm happy to share this information. I must tell you, I don't believe in saying something that I have not experienced. I don't believe in that. I have not come to teach you anything. You all know this. Everything I'm saying is in the books. Everything can be heard from any teacher, any guru, any satsang. You can hear the same things. I've not come to say that. I only come to say, please practice and you will find. Please, you have got something most valuable. Please practice, you'll get it. Would any of you like to actually meditate what I'm saying? So it doesn't remain a talk, but actually a walk into the journey. How many of you would like an actual meditation? I'm very happy to see so many. We'll do it tomorrow morning. 11 o'clock, I'll be here for that. And I'll explain more things. If you have a question about what I've said today, will you please write it on a piece of paper? We'll supply the paper. Is there? We have paper, small slips of paper. If you have any question on what I have been telling today, or any question that is in your mind and I have not spoken about it, please write it. and I will try my best to give you the answers to as many questions as I can also tomorrow. Okay? So you don't go back with questions in your head without getting any answers. The mind questions a lot. It's important to get the answers. If you don't get answers to your doubting mind, you won't make any progress. Every time you want to do something, the mind will come, put its spoke in. What about that? No answer. But limit your answer in your head to a genuine problem you are facing. Not questions about the whole theory of creation. Not whole theory whether God exists or not God exists. Not those kind of questions. Because those questions you can keep asking all your life. You remember the story of the man who fell into a well. There was no parapet wall. Well was level in a village. He was a professor, intellectual guy, thinking something else and walking in the dark. He fell into the well. Fortunately, the water was shallow. He did not drown. He was halfway in the water. Began to moan and groan. How would I fall into the well? Feeling very unhappy. Some passerby, a villager, heard the professor's groaning voice in the well and he came. He said, I'm sorry, you've fallen into the well. Wait, I will go and bring a rope and I will lower the rope. You can catch it. You try to climb on the rope or I'll pull you out. The professor said, before you go to bring the rope, please tell me, why did I fall into the well? And also, before you go to bring the rope, also tell me that how will I believe that you will bring the rope? No, that's not all. Also tell me that when you come and have a rope and you lower the rope, how will I know that when I'm halfway up, you'll not throw me again? Please answer my questions before you go and collect the rope. The villager said, wouldn't it be nice if I pulled you out and then answered these questions? No, I won't touch your rope till you first answer all my questions. The villager said, then stay in the well. Some of us start asking that question. No, we will not move forward. Tell us all the answers to all these questions. Tell us the whole metaphysics before we make a step. I know some people who have been questioning all their life and died. Never left anywhere. Yes, ask questions which are bothering you. Ask questions which are stopping you from discovering yourself. Ask practical questions and I'll try and give you all the answers. Questioning is good, but too much can be just putting you into questioner's basket and you go on asking questions, getting answers. Why is that? Let me tell you. The spiritual path, talking of this spiritual path. The spiritual path has many contradictions. That is why there are so many questions. Is it necessary to do a lot of meditation, 8 hours or more, to get insight? Question number one. Question number two. Can trying to meditate give us anything, or is it only the Guru's grace that gives us? Question number two. Number three, can we pray for grace or grace comes by itself? Question number three. I can give you 100 questions like this. All contradicting each other. Is effort going to give it or grace going to give it? Should you wait for grace? His grace may come or you can do something? I can tell you many stories of people who have been caught up in these questions and saying books are full of contradictions. They are. Because the answers given are at different levels of our awareness. If a newcomer comes on the spiritual path and wants to know, what should I do? Answer, meditate as much as you can. When he has meditated enough and nothing happens, and he puts the same question again, I meditated so much, nothing happened. Look, brother, look, sister, this does not come by meditation, come by grace. Both answers correct for the same person at two different times. The answers can be different for two people at the same time. A man came to great master. His young daughter, teenage daughter was with him. He said, Master, my daughter has grown up and we are saying she should now be married. And she is saying she ought to study, go to college. What should we do? Great Master said, what is the difference between boys and girls? If boys can go to college, so can girls. Send them to college. The father said, thank you. Girl was happy. They left. Within 10 minutes, this is a true story. Within 10 minutes, another man comes with his teenage daughter. And he says, Master, my daughter has grown up and we are saying we should marry her. She says, I want to go to college. What should we do? He said, what are girls to do with college? They should be housewives. Marry her. 10 minutes, two different answers. Which one was correct? We start applying to ourselves, should our teenage daughter get married or go to college? What did Great Master say? Oh, somebody read first story. He said, go to send to college. Second said, no, he never said that. He said, marry her. Great Master gave correct answers to those two, but both are incorrect for us. What we are trying to see is what Master said sometime in the book of Master's letters to Americans, I know, spiritual gems, it's called, giving different answers to different people. And we're reading the book, applying it to ourselves. Don't forget, when a master looks at us, he's not seeing our body. He's not seeing our face. He's not seeing our eyes. He's seeing who we are, the soul trapped with karma. He sees our karmic pattern. And sees how we are trapped, at what area of that entrapment we are, when can we get out, what is needed at that time, and he gives a customized answer to that question. It's only applicable for the questioner, nobody else. The answer can be quite different from anybody else. So one must have relevant questions pertaining to yourself and not say, because I heard Master give certain answer to somebody, that must apply to me. It may not. Write the questions. I'll try my best to write the answers or speak out the answers for you. Some questions may be general questions relevant to all. And when I give the answer, so many people can get the same answer in their own mind to questions. So I'll see you tomorrow. We'll do meditation. I answer questions. And we'll go on for the third day also. With this 3-day event in New Delhi. I'm very happy that I could come and see all of you. All of you are seekers of the same path I am. We are all co-travelers to Sachkhand, our true home. I'm very happy to be your friend and travel together with you. Thank you very much.